வணக்கம் நேர்களே, மற்றும் நிகழ்ச்சியுடன் சந்திக்கிறோம். உங்களுக்கு தெரியும், இலங்கையில் தற்போது புதிய ஒரு அரசியல் யாப்பினை உருவாக்குவதற்கான முயற்சிகள் மேற்கொள்ளப்பட்டு வருகின்றன. இதற்காக இலங்கையினுடைய பாராளுமன்றம், கான்ஸ்டிடியூஷன் அசம்பிளி, அதாவது அரசியலமைப்பு சபையாக மாற்றப்பட்டிருக்கிறது. இலங்கை அரசாங்கம் இப்போது புதியொரு அரசியலமைப்பை உருவாக்குவதற்காக இப்போது கலந்துரையாடல்களை மேற்கொண்டு வருகிறது. நாடாராவிய ரீதியில் வடக்கிலும் சரி, கிழக்கிலும் சரி, தெற்கிலும் பகுதி சரி, மக்கள் மத்தியில் இந்த தமது அரசியலமைப்பில் உள்ளடக்கப்பட்டு வர வேண்டிய விடயங்கள் குறித்து அவர்கள் இப்போது கலந்துரையாடல்களை மேற்கொண்டு வருகிறார்கள். ஆகவே இந்த அரசியலமைப்பின் ஊடாக புதிய அரசாங்கம் அல்லது புதிய அரசியலமைப்பின் ஊடாக இலங்கை மக்களுக்கு கிடைக்கக்கூடிய என்ன, அதிலிருந்து என்ன எதிர்பார்க்கப்படுகிறது, அல்லது இந்த புதிய அரசியலமைப்பின் ஊடாக அடையப்பட முயற்சிக்கப்படும் விடயங்கள் என்னென்ன என்பது குறித்து கலந்துரையாடுவதற்காக இன்று நாம் நிலைய கலையத்துக்கு ஒரு விசேட விருந்தினரை அழைத்திருக்கிறோம். அவர் வேறு யாருமல்ல, கலாநிதி ஜெயம்பதி விக்ரமரத்னம் அவர்கள், இலங்கை பாராளுமன்றத்தினுடைய தேசிய நாடாளுமன்ற தேசிய பட்டிய நாடாளுமன்ற உறுப்பினராக இருக்கக்கூடிய அவர், லங்கா சமசமாஜ கட்சியினுடைய பெரும்பான்மை உறுப்பினர்களை கொண்ட பகுதியின் நாடாளுமன்ற உறுப்பினர்களும் இருக்கிறார். அவர் உங்களுக்கு தெரியும், இலங்கையில் இருக்கக்கூடிய மிக சொற்ப அரசியலமைப்பு நிபுணர்களில், சட்டத்துறை வல்லுநர்களில் இவர் மிக முக்கியமானவர். கடந்த காலங்களில் இலங்கையில் அரசியலமைப்பின் யாப்பில் திருத்தங்கள் மேற்கொள்ளப்படும் போது இவருடைய அனுசரணையும் இவருடைய அறிவுரையும் பாரதிய அளவில் பெற்றுக்கொள்ளப்பட்டிருக்கிறது. தற்போது ஜனாதிபதியினுடைய ஆலோசகராக இவர் கடமையாற்றி வருகிறார். தற்போது பிரித்தானியா வந்திருக்கும் அவர் எங்களுடன் கலந்துரையாடுவதற்கு இங்கே வந்திருக்கிறார். அது மட்டுமில்லை, தற்போது அந்த நாடாளுமன்றத்தை அரசியலமைப்பு சபையாக மாற்றப்பட்டிருக்கிறது. அந்த அரசியலமைப்பு குழுவினுடைய அங்கத்தவராக அவர் செயற்பட்டு வருகிறார். ஆகவே இலங்கையில் தற்போது புதிய அரசியல் அமைப்பு தொடர்பாக மேற்கொள்ளப்படும் முயற்சிகள் தொடர்பாக அவருடன் நாம் இன்று கலந்துரையாட இருக்கிறோம். டாக்டர் ஜெயம்பதி விக்ரமரத்னம், தேங்க்ஸ் ஃபார் ஜாயினிங் அஸ்.
தேங்க் யூ ஃபார் த ஆப்பர்ச்சுனிட்டி.
அண்ட் யூ ஹவ் பின் ஒர்க்கிங் ஆன் திஸ் கான்ஸ்டியூஷன் அண்ட் மேக்கிங் அ நியூ கான்ஸ்டியூஷன். இன் த பாஸ்ட் யூ ஹவ் ஒர்க் ஆன் கான்ஸ்டியூஷன் மேக்கிங் டிஃப்ரெண்ட் ரிஃபார்ம்ஸ். வாட் இஸ் திஸ் நியூ கான்ஸ்டியூஷன் ஆல் அபவுட்? வை டூ யூ திங்க் கண்ட்ரி நீட்ஸ் அ நியூ கான்ஸ்டியூஷன்?
Firstly, the present constitution is based on the executive presidency, very strong centralized state with very strong executive presidency. Now the foundations of the 1978 constitution have already been shattered, right? Firstly with the 13th amendment, which changed that centralized structure to some extent and brought in provincial councils, and you have in the provincial councils a parliamentary form of government, whereas you have in the center a presidential form of government. That itself is a contradiction. You don't find it in many countries. In India, it's parliamentary both in the center, in the states. In the US, it is both executive form of government, both in the center and the states. So in Sri Lanka, you have this mixture. That itself has created problems. Then it is the executive presidency that I think, in my view, it is the executive presidency that paved the way for authoritarianism. And we have been able, by the 19th Amendment, to take away much of the powers, many of the powers of that executive presidency. So we cannot build... So that also shattered the foundation in a way. So there is no point in building a new constitution on this old foundation. It's not possible. And we also have to look into the future. I'm talking not only about merely a new constitution, but a new constitution which has a futuristic vision. While we have to respond to the past, we also have to look beyond that and also see whether we can have a constitution which has a futuristic vision. You can make a constitution looking at the future with a blank stare. You can also make a constitution with a futuristic vision, and I prefer the latter. Right. And that is why we need a new constitution.
But when they talk about new constitution, they talk more of taking away the presidents of the powers of the president and making parliament accountable for the activities of the government. How will that make a better government? Because in the past, we have red tape and, the bureaucracy and all that. In the past, this executive president has taken decisions. Some decisions, many decisions were wrong, but when a powerful person in a country can take decisions, like President Kumaratunga, one stage said that Prabhakaran can have Northeast for 10 years. That is the intention of make sure that peace prevails in the country. So how do you think taking away the... Is it the presidency or the person who handles it?
I think it is the presidency. It is the legal framework which gives the president the powers. That is the problem. And if you take Mr. Rajapaksa, he used his powers to the utmost. And what was more interesting was that he went beyond such powers, right? And subverted parliament. Parliament became a mere pawn in his hands. And the judiciary, the independence of the judiciary was interfered with. The public service became virtually a slave of the rulers, even the media, right? So therefore, it is the presidency with all its powers that enabled such a thing to happen.
For instance, now if you look at this, whether it's military land grab or militarization in the north or releasing the lands to the civilians after the war, president can act fastly than going through the parliament. Doesn't it help the minorities?
How can the president act bypassing parliament? The legislation is made by parliament. So legislation on any matter is made by parliament.
But president has taken action to release lands, for instance.
Yeah, but he does that together with the cabinet of ministers, which represents parliament. The prime minister and the cabinet of ministers prime minister is the person who commands the support of the majority of the house. So it is not only the president that is acting, the president together with the cabinet of ministers. The president is still the head of the cabinet of ministers, all right. But we have today parliament also quite powerful. So it's not just using presidential powers. It is also the president working together with the cabinet of ministers and with the cabinet of ministers answerable to the parliament.
Before we discuss further on the constitutional aspect and the new constitution, the President Sirisena, Maithripala Sirisena, I think when he quit the SLP, broke away from the Rajapaksa alliance, he said he will completely abolish the executive presidency. But after becoming the president, he said that Balathala Adukarno, he said he's reducing the powers of the president, he will still keep some powers with him.
No, not he who said that. I mean, some of the political parties, especially the JHU, Jalitha Gehlawurumaya, was not for the complete abolition of the executive presidency at that time. So there had to be a compromise. So for the common candidate to be supported by the widest possible range of political parties. Therefore, it was agreed that at the first stage of reform, powers would be whittled down. But now, since then, the president has made it very clear now that he wants total abolition. There may be political parties who still say the president should have certain powers. I have no problem with the president having certain powers. But basically, it must be a parliamentary form of government. My position, the position of the Lankasama Samaja Party majority group that I represent, is that we are for total abolition. But having said that, I must say that some of the safeguards that were brought in by the 17th Amendment, negated by the 18th Amendment, and still brought back with more strength in the 19th Amendment, should apply even to the parliamentary form of government, like the Constitutional Council process, the independent commissions, the appointment of judges, the manner of appointment of the Attorney General, etc., the independent commissions. Those should continue to be there, although they were brought into to weaken the, or rather put limitations on the presidency. That doesn't mean that they should be done away with when we go to parliamentary form of government. Because under parliamentary form of government, there is always the possibility of misuse of power. So I think some of the features of the 19th Amendment should go into the new constitution as well.
You said the president has to move away from his position, initial position, that he should need, executive president should
no,
be.
No, he never said that he is for, he is only for taking away some of the powers.
But we have clips, the president saying that first he said, Sampoorna Ahos Karno.
Yeah,
then he said, Balatal Adu Karno.
ඔබේ ගෞරවනීය ඡන්දේ පාවිච්චි කරන්න විධායක ජනාධිපති ධුරය දින 100ක් ඇතුළත අහෝසි කිරීම සඳහා
අපි මැතිවරණයේදී බොහොම පැහැදිලිව කියලා තියෙන්නේ විධායක ජනාධිපති ධුරයේ තිබෙන අසීමිත බලතල ඉවත් කරනවායි කියලා හිතන්.
Yeah, but that was because the coalition of parties that decided to support him took that comment.
But isn't it dangerous that the JHU, you said that he has to revert that position because the JHU has insisted that some powers has to be left
at
the
that
president.
Point.
Yeah, but now, in terms of giving minority rights, for instance, or some other issues, that if some coalition parties oppose, how can you go with the new constitution?
A new constitution is going to be a compromise constitution. Unlike the 72 Constitution and the 78 Constitution. The 78 Constitution was imposed by and large by the United Front. The 1978 Constitution was imposed by the United National Party. This time around, it is a completely different situation, where the United National Party does not have a simple majority. The Sri Lanka Freedom Party does not have a simple majority. But the two together, forming a government, have a comfortable majority in government, but still not two-thirds majority. Yeah. But with the support of the Tamil parties and certain other small parties that sit in the opposition, we have more than a two-thirds majority, 163 votes. The budget was passed in 163 votes. So you have the potential. So it will have to be a compromise. It will be a, I stand for total abolition, but I don't know what the final outcome would be. I will stand for and fight for total abolition. But let's see how it works. Right?
The parliamentary equation is very important. You see, last May 1st election, May Day function, nearly 40 MPs have gone with Rajapaksas.
38, I believe. Not all of them are from the SLP, though. That includes people, MPs from other parties also.
Yeah.
I think some this number of SLP MPs was about 30. I don't know the exact number, just about 30.
But anyway,
a certain amount went there.
Yes, but I say, is talking about the majority, the parliament equations. Do you think that will stand forever?
I think my own view, when from also
no,
from also from also from the lobby talk, right? I think the joint opposition will get still weaker. And May Day, President Sirisena was able to show that he carries with him that he has the support of a substantial section of the SLAP. It was a very big show. The Kirlapana show was not only Mahinda Rajapaksa's, but the other parties were also there.
Whereas
the Gaul event was basically an SLAP. So you can see the tide turning. It's turning. It's different. It's going to be worse for the joint opposition in the time.
Absolutely. But what we see is, before the media elections, there were a lot of ministers, including the president. They kept saying that those who violate the party principles will be dealt with. There will be stern disciplinary action taken against them. But today, the Sunday Observer has reported the general secretary of the party is in negotiation with these dissidents, or rather people who have gone behind Rajapaksa's, to get them back to the fold.
I don't think as a responsible political party, I'm sure the SLAP would like to get back some of the distance. Some of those people who are in the joint opposition, I know them. Some of whom I know personally, some of whom know by reputation, are good parliamentarians, good people who deserve to be with Sirisena and not with Rajapaksa. So naturally, the SLFP would like to rein in some of those good MPs, right? So that I'm not surprised at all. But then there are a few bad eggs with whom they need to, about whom they have to take a decision, and I'm sure they will.
But, you know, looking at the media rallies, left parties, especially yours, that of yours, which the left party which has been calling for the devolution of powers. How do you rate your demonstration?
Compared to last year.
Yeah.
Last year, only the LSSP majority wing and the alternate group of the Communist Party marched. But this time, the Navasama Samaja Party also came with their trade unions. And some of the trade unions joined us, like Saman Ratna Priyas and other political parties, other trade unions. And we had a show which was much better than last time. Very happy.
What does that mean? Do you think the people are more towards devolution of
powers? No, it was not on devolution, right? It was a show of left unity. And we are now talking to other parties also. And especially the parties in the north, which have a left orientation, and we hope to talk to them in the future and strengthen. We are very happy with our outcome on May Day. Compared to last year, we have done much better, and we have also brought in other fraternal parties onto our platform.
Will that be confined to the mere show of strength, or do you think that will be taken forward further in terms of whatever they have promised?
We would like to. We would ideally like to have a united left front formation.
Are you working on that?
We are seriously working on that.
But other parties went to talks?
No, firstly the LSSP and the CP groups, and then we would also like to speak to the Navasama Samaja Party, and as I said, the Northern Political Party, who are pro-left.
Mr. Vikramanda, tell me about the constitution. You are talking about the abolition of executive presidency. What are the other key elements that the new constitution?
I think the key ones are electoral reform, because the people are fed up with this present system of manapes, the preferential voting, but also ensure that the smaller parties don't get played out. So that overall representation, overall, in my view, we should have a system where the overall representation is proportional, but also have electorates so that every citizen has an MP of his or her own. So it's a mixture of FPP, first past the post, and proportional, a system which is called the mixed member proportional system. That is something being seriously being discussed, and most parties appear to be comfortable with the principle behind it. We have to work out the details. Then, of course, the crucial thing is a set constitutional settlement of the ethnic issue. And we have the experiences of the 13th Amendment, 28 years of experience with the 13th Amendment, how it worked and how it did not work, how successive governments used, virtually, literally speaking, every full stop and every comma in the 13th Amendment to take back powers, how the Divinagama Bill was enacted, and even subjects like agrarian services were taken back to the center. How judgments were...
See you.